about prayer, we came up with a couple of different quotes that were encouraging to us. I thought I'd read those out to you. Prayer is a relationship wherein we humbly communicate, worship, and sincerely seek God's face, knowing that He hears us, loves us, and will respond, though not always in a manner that we may expect or desire. Prayer can encompass confession, praise, adoration, supplication, intercession, and more. And the next one is that prayer is the most wonderful act in the spiritual realm, as well as a most mysterious affair. And then prayer is an invitation of communication with our God. And then I love this last one. It says we should pray about anything that hinders our prayer.
All right, so overview of prayer, we just kind of picked a couple verses here. I don't want to read them all off to you just because I don't want to waste time and I'm long-winded anyway. But what I took from, you know, this first one especially is just is expectant. All the times in the Gospels when Jesus talks about praying, but when you pray, while you're doing this, it's like it's already expected of us to do. It's also, it's continual, and then, you know, the second one, be joyful, and hope, patient, affliction, faith from prayer, and the fourth one, they're praying continually. It's a continual process. I think the quote in the book was kind of like taking a phone call. You should, even if you got to put it on hold and, you know, go about your life, work, you can't constantly be in communication with God, but always ready to pick that call back up. This quote from Whitney. Also, just, you know, devoted. Devote yourself to prayer, be watchful and thankful. So it's something you got to devote yourself to. It doesn't just come supernaturally, but it should be your essence of, you know, what you're trying just to live. And with being watchful and thankful is, you know, how to do that. And this last one, pray in the Spirit on all occasions, with all kinds of prayer petition, with thanksgiving, present all your requests to God. Just being bold in prayer. You know, we're called to, not our God's an all-powerful God, He can do anything. You know, being ready for, you know, not to get the answers you always want, but the answers, you know, that God obviously knows you need. And but being, just be bold in taking those petitions and requests to God.
Yeah, and here's just a couple ways that we can see this expressed. So the first in personal prayer time, these are both examples where Jesus went away and prayed, so by himself. The second is for extended periods of time. This is Jesus going to a mountain, and he prays throughout the whole entire night. So it's not just a little quick right before he go to bed that he actually stayed up. This is third one is in faith, hopeful, in God's will. This is a parable, actually, that we see persistence play through. And then the last three, partner up, so praying with others. That's where that community aspect comes in. The second last one, journal our prayers. Prayers don't actually only have to be verbal. It can happen. In a book, you can write those down. And then the last one's on our knees, on our face before God. So maybe most of what we're out there.
Okay, continuing off of that, just some more ways to apply that, taking a prayer walk, maybe in the morning or whatever. And praying scripture, which is something that I think that was the big one for me while trying to practice this. You just like actually use, being intentional while going into it and using scripture as like my backbone source for what I was praying about, what I was praying for. And then Bible reading is the listening side of prayer, so kind of feedback off of that. So just recognizing again that relationship and the weapon that gives power against.
Yes, and then this quote on the bottom is from Jill Briscoe, and transitions into our final example for prayer. It takes work to step out of time into eternity and work to leave things undone so that greater things can be done. Prayer must be planned.
And so this is just an example of something that I've done over the years, on and off, and it's, gives me some structure. And what I plan to do in this group was I plan to pray with a partner. So I have a good friend we used to meet for breakfast. Now we meet Friday mornings and we pray scripture for our children and our grandchildren. And it's going very well. I've also read a book. It was one of my goals to read a book on prayer. And one of the things that I learned from that and gleaned from that and reflected on is that somebody prayed for me. Somebody prayed for you guys. And just the fact that there are some people out there that maybe nobody's prayed for. So throughout my day, I might run into somebody at the grocery store, I can't share the gospel with her, but I can lift up in prayer.
I can start off. So what I did during this month was just to, my hope was to meditate and pray over scripture as I read it. I would say something I learned.
don't, not in scripture quite as much as I thought I would be, but yeah, a success I found in it was that when I would take a verse in my reading and meditate over it, I found myself reflecting on it later on in the day, or thinking about that passage more often than if I had just like read through that passage and not meditated on a specific verse. So that was pretty cool. Yeah, those are kind of my big takeaways from that.
Yeah, I just put it off the sheet that we used with the youth a couple weeks ago. I'll put a bunch of them on the table and back if you want to take it. Drew's ultimated, not me, so he gets credit. We used it with the youth. Just kind of how to prepare for praying to tragedy, you know, terrible things happen in the world. Some are like, it's hard for me to pray, but without just being like, God, you know what you say, but actually articulate it. And it just kind of gives you like how to prepare, and then just know, what do we know about God, truths about God, and how to rest in that, and just through that, like even the night we went through it with the youth, like you could see how we went from not knowing what to say or how to talk about it. This was right after the Las Vegas tragedy, but you know, there's been several tragedies every day since then. Just a sheet that I think is helpful for people. I'm going to put a bunch on the back table. I found a lot of fruit with it, just like focusing on what we know about God and praying that. Here is just kind of praying that scripture, just God's word back to him.
Wrap up thoughts? I have one too I can add. For me, something that's really helpful with prayer is recalling God's faithfulness. I know it's easy to, you know, write down things that we want to pray about and then kind of forget about it, and a lot of times I forget if I don't intentionally go back and recognize, wow, Lord, you answered this prayer request in such a specific way, and that, you know, increases my trust for him, and that he answers prayers not only in the way that we think he will, but it's just recalling the faithfulness of God is really an encouragement.
And so this is kind of just a wrap-up quote, kind of a closing quote here by Rick Warren. People may refuse our love or reject our message. They are defenseless and uncertain.
So bad.
There it is, Microsoft. Thanks, guys.
Meadows. Like, I was thinking we could just stand up there and be like, we're gonna have 6 minutes of just prayer.
That'd be a good way to do it.
Scripture memorization. I think we all can agree that reading the Bible is an important goal for any Christian. But I often find that as soon as I put that book down, I've forgotten what I was reading. In fact, I try to reflect on Scripture and check myself before God on the drive into work, but I can't remember what I read just 30 minutes before. This is why I feel like Scripture memorization is very valuable. It's an opportunity to put the Bible into our mind, and it gives God the opportunity to bring it, present it in front of us, whenever he chooses, whenever the Holy Spirit wants to speak to us. For me, it feels a bit like learning a new language. I don't know if you've studied language before, but you don't just read a list of verbs and then walk away knowing Swahili. Is that how it works? Memorizing anything is super hard, but it's worth it.
So ways that scripture memory can be expressed, the Holy Spirit can speak through you using scripture. So if you can quote scripture and bring it into a conversation, it's a great way to represent God's truth accurately. It's also helpful when you're witnessing or in a counseling situation. Having scriptures memorized helps validate what God's saying and kind of bring work that into your ministry. The Holy Spirit can also speak to me personally through scripture when it's in my mind and ready to recall when I need it most. It's a good reminder of his word. No matter where I am, I don't have to be carving out the time to be reading at that moment, but if the verse is there, I can bring it when I need to know it. And it strengthens my faith by reinforcing those truths. And in the book it says that the weapon we need, a scripture memory is the weapon we need in spiritual battle. So it's God's word is the sword, and so having that ready to wield for both inward and outward struggle is highly valuable.
Yeah, so when we came together as a group and kind of talked about the ways that we wanted to like practice our assignment and the verses that we wanted to memorize, there was a lot of overlap like in the methods and the ways that we wanted to go about doing it. But something that we kind of noticed was that we tend to gravitate towards one way of memorizing versus another depending on like your learning style, like if you're a kinesthetic learner, auditory, visual. I'm a very visual learner and auditory, so you know, I've got my little post-its, so I'd write down my verses and stick them on the mirror. I also have like a Bible app on my phone, and so since I don't want to be looking at my post-its while I'm driving, I just have the audio playback on while I'm in the car, like on my commute or something. That's really helpful. And then I think also something that came up was using a translation that is easy for you to memorize. I think usually the NIV is a pretty good one. It just kind of flows a little bit more naturally. So those were some of the methods that we came up with to help you.
Yeah, when we came together, we also looked at what was impediments to us memorizing scripture. Kind of even before you find the space to do it, number one, it might be really daunting. So you might hear a lot of lies coming in, and just it's even like leading up to the time that you find the space, like spend that amount of time arguing with yourself to get there. And then the biggest thing then would be like, okay, now making the time. So now that you actually have the space, there might also be a mental focus that is lacking. So got your Do Not Disturb might not be on, or we're just not very good at being focused. And then distractions that might come in. So even if you do have Do Not Disturb on, you might still have a coworker or a friend come in when you're over lunch or whatever. And also some of the things that might impede you is version, like Emily mentioned. I started memorizing in ESV, but then realized that was a lot easier than NIV. And then also one thing that can kind of turn to an excuse sometimes, but is kind of missing the context sometimes. If you're going to focus on one verse, you might be worried about, well, I'm missing more of it. So making sure that you're kind of knowing what's around the scripture that you're memorizing.
And some things that might kind of help you in terms of working well in memorization, I think for me, one of the personal quotes that I use is an African proverb, right? If you were to eat an elephant, how would you do it? You take one bite at a time. And as far as Whitney's great quotes, as far as memorization and meditation, kind of metaphors it in terms of like a fire, right? When you go towards a fire and you want to get warm, you don't spend just 2 seconds at that fire. You walk up to it, and then you take some time. You sit down, and then it warms up your clothes, your skin, and then your bones, and then you're truly warm. So that is how you meditate on it. And as a group, here are some of our key learnings, kind of just to wrap up as a whole. I gained a greater appreciation of the Holy Spirit and how He is able to speak to me using Scripture. When I memorize, I feel like I'm learning to speak the language of God. I was reminded of the benefit to having Scripture accessible while I'm on the go. My thoughts with me no matter how busy my schedule. Scripture memory allows me to meditate on God's Word anytime, any place. I discovered that having Scripture ready in your mind is incredibly helpful to mortifying sin. I obtained a better realization of the importance of memorizing Scripture word for word with reference. In addition, creating my own plan, goals, and timeline for memorization is key rather than keeping an academic perspective based on past circumstances. It's vital for me to have words from God to replace the thoughts and worries I shouldn't be dwelling on. It's not enough to stop thinking those things. They have to be replaced with something good. Memorization to me means engaging in hand-to-hand combat with the mind, ushering in discipline and making more room for the Word of God instead of the Word of the world. It takes intentional effort to move towards spiritual adulthood. Thank you.
All right. So I couldn't memorize it.
NIV.
Of worship comes from the word worship, which really means how do we address and approach God as he is worthy. I think that's a really interesting topic to dig into. Now, when we're looking at the worthiness of God, what do we do to be successful? Well, worship is done biblically in spirit and in truth. That is, we look to rely on the power of the Holy Spirit when pursuing worship and look to meditate and reflect on the truths that are found in Scripture there. Now, we can approach worship in a way that almost feels like a sense of duty, which isn't really how we want to approach worship. Rather, we want to approach worship out of, or in love and out of joy, to find success there. And then there's both personal worship as well as corporate worship, and they're both very much so necessary. We can't look to pursue worship only at church on Sundays, or in contrast, individually in our quiet time on a daily basis. One of the other things we found as we were digging into worship is that it is something that very often is found when practicing other spiritual disciplines. And now I'd like to hand it over to Nolan to talk a little bit about how one of the ways we talked about worship.
Yeah, so one of the ways that I most often, and particularly the last 2 months, have honestly struggled to get back into the habit of doing is scripture reading. And I have some reasons there. I'm going to read a quote from When I Don't Desire God, J. Piper, Toast, recommend. He says, "The Bible leads us to superior and lasting joy because it leads us to Christ, especially to see his glory and enjoy his fellowship." So when I think about approaching the Bible in anything, I feel like it brings me to evoke worship. When I have scripture memorization going, when I'm reading the Bible, when I'm consistently going to it, it fills my mind with vocabulary, with stories, with thoughts, with promises that are not by nature mine. I don't come across them just by my own random stray thoughts. It actually introduces the thoughts of God and changes my worldview. And so it changes the way I pray, it changes the way I do discipline. My time with others, it informs that. And I use some hyphens. It's faith arousing, it's mind focusing. Fruit producing, joy evoking, it really just, it brings me to worship. If I have the scriptures running through my mind and life, it really creates a culture of worship within me.
So the question that Whitney asked and that my group asked me was, Elizabeth, what in your life this month is causing you to worship the Creator? By the way, all these pictures are used with permission of parents. And I would obviously pick kids especially because that's my favorite. But mostly it just turned out like I like worship God the most when I see joy in unexpected places and places that only God would really work through, which also translates into serving others, and I think that works too. Like seeing these, this was just my appreciation this month of how I worship God. I mean, have you ever seen someone appreciate grass like that? Like, I don't appreciate grass like that. It was like, holy cow, this is the most amazing thing. And like, I was like, you know what? This is an amazing thing. Like, grass is cool. Just like all the joy of the things that I could miss that God has created and called me to worship. If I missed serving, like, you know, the least of these or people who appreciate different things than me, then I would have missed a lot of opportunities to worship. And watching the Creator turn like situations that someone could say like, wow, that's a really hard thing, or like, that's just really sad. Like, the Creator turns that into joy and like brings you joy through unexpected places. And that's how I experienced worship this month.
So I tried a bunch of different things just because what we discovered is that the definition of worship as by Whitney is like responding to who God is. And so for me, like that can take so many different forms. take a look at that, but one of the things that I'll just tell you about quickly as an example was I was going for a walk and I was listening to a podcast, you know, walking, podcast, like thinking about who God is, that sort of thing, and I got to the end of this dock and I looked up while I was listening to my little sermon and I saw these like birds circling above me and immediately like my heart, I felt like the Holy Spirit put on my heart that verse about like God and the sparrows and like when one falls he sees it, how much more does he care about you? And I like, if you know me, like I'm a crier and I just like lost it, 100% I did. And I felt like it was absolutely like, I think that was the biggest thing I learned is that worship, even the ability to like respond to God is just a gift from God. Like the Holy Spirit moving in me so that I can respond to him, so that I can notice him. And that's, so I think there is a bunch of different ways to do that, but in that moment I realized that worship, the ability to do so, is even just a gift.
This month I got to go on a beautiful, fun, adventurous trip to Portland, Oregon, and that was somewhere I had never been before. So just adventure in general was something that I was excited for. And I just was so amazed by just the season of fall and just the beautiful colors that I got to see while I was out there. That alone was just like, made me be in awe. And so I got to go hiking and just see a lot of beautiful scenery. And one thing I just noticed about the cat picture was like, if you've ever seen like a picture on Instagram or something, that you're like, oh, they totally probably use like filters to edit that. And I had that in mind when I saw that view and I was like, no, this is totally real. Like these pictures don't do justice, but like this is not like a paid thing that they like created to like look really cool. Like this is like a really awesome thing that God created, and that just like brought my heart to rejoice. And then this quote is from the book, worship can't be calculated or produced. Instead, it is evoked. It is a response of a heart evoked by beauty, glory, and allure of the object of your mental focus, Holy God.
One of the things I listened to during this was a podcast by the guy that does the Bible Project, and he talked about how we so often, he quoted Dallas Willard, we so often focus on that we're supposed to follow Jesus' teachings. But Jesus expected that we would follow his whole way of life, and solitude was a huge part of Jesus' way of life. It said in Luke 5:16, Mark 1:35, Matthew 14:23, Jesus withdrew, he was alone. Or he even commanded his disciples to withdraw so that they could pray and be recharged. And then there's a quote from Willard here. Jesus made disciples by presenting them with the kingdom and then introducing them into it by reaching in their hearts, changing their vision. And you do that through solitude.
Solitude encompasses many other disciplines, but it is always expressed alone. No technology and no other voices except God's. Solitude is a regular pattern of practice of prayerful meditation on scripture. This can be for a minute or an hour. It can even be a special weekend retreat, but never less than a daily practice. Now for all of my fellow introverts out there, I know solitude comes easy because this is our natural habitat. And this is the best weekend ever. But
God's story and letting him tell you who you are because of what he has done. Solitude is being still before the Lord, who is seeking his face, drawing near to him, and delighting in his law and meditating on it. Therefore, solitude is for everyone.
So we each had a bunch of plans to try and make solitude a priority these past few weeks. I'll probably touch on one. And there are also some ideas in the chapter about areas that we could focus on during our solitude, so I wrote those up there in orange as well.
Mm-hmm.
Chris decided to use his commute time to focus on God. Sheena focused on worship, so she chose to read a psalm every single morning or two. Nathan wanted to take intermittent short breaks throughout the day to get away and focus on God. I chose to focus on limiting distractions during my morning quiet times. Katie also chose her commute to focus on God. And Paul focused on restoration, so he chose to take any lull in his crazy schedule and get away and be alone with God. So I wrote yay and nay for some of our successes and not successes. You can see we were pretty successful at figuring out how to make solitude a priority. Chris, the fruit of his solitude was that during his small group, he had talked less so he could hear and enjoy others' opinions more. Sheena was able to effectively read a psalm every single morning. Nathan, I put in nay because he realized that taking multiple tiny breaks throughout the day wasn't as conducive to his schedule as he originally thought. I actually loved this exercise because in my quiet times, I didn't realize how much I was focusing on me during them. So now I started focusing on God more by limiting all of the outside distractions. Katie, I put yay and nay because throughout the week, she better focused in on her commutes, focusing on God. She struggled a little bit with expressing faith to God, but still had solid solitude times. And then Paul even wrote some cool poems during his solitude.
He's going to read them.
Okay. So some of the difficulties, if you're a big deal on social media like Paul, you gotta tend to your likes. A big thing about for when we're at work, there was a fear of being seen as lazy if you get caught not producing work, but instead withdrawing. There was a general lack of focus and desire, and I think a big part of that just came from a lack of understanding how important solitude was to Jesus' work here on earth. And then just the exhaustion, part of our American dream is just always going. So those of us that save solitude for late in the day or even at night tended to either just fall asleep or forget altogether.
So then from all of our experiences, we kind of pulled together some helpful hints that we could share with you guys to take forward. The first thing is kind of start small, back to like prophets, you know, eat an elephant one bite at a time. Same thing with this. Doing something, anything, better than nothing. So even if you're not as like consistent, at least starting is great. To help start, set a time, set a schedule, even if it's kind of one of the things Prophet used, even though it wasn't as successful with like picking a time, if it's gonna be like at noon every day or at 10:23 every day, you're gonna like take a break, you know, just stop and drop, turn and like focus on the Lord from whatever you were doing. That helps a lot, kind of getting it scheduled if you need to get like a reminder in your calendar or your phone. The other piece too would be sometimes it's hard to just add one more thing, just one more thing to the list. So trying to repurpose that time that you already have existing, which is why so many of us, I think Chris and I both picked commuting, because most of us have to do that. I mean, unless you work from home, even if you do work from home, you still have to get up and go somewhere, like the grocery store or church at least. Yeah, okay. So some of the things, don't have a plane, actually have a plan. topic, stick with that. However, because we do get distracted, so if you want to stay focused and minimize distractions, get rid of your phone.
These are all the things we learned.
You can say it was
okay. So I think the thing about this that we learned most is that last thing on the list says that our time with God is really how he tunes his heart, tunes our heart to match really his and to really align our will with his. We're called to imitate Christ, and the one passage that I really keyed on this month, this
this last week was really the Garden of Gethsemane, when Jesus really withdraws even from his own disciples and really spends really concerted time with the Lord and effort to really understand his will and really ultimately sacrifice his own will for that of the Father's. And so that's something that we all like to talk about.
Meditation group. I want to briefly introduce the topic, and then we're just each person's going to share a little bit about their own personal experience with it, a minute or so. Starting with definition. This is from Whitney. I think it's concise and useful. It says, "Let's define meditation as deep thinking on the truths and spiritual realities revealed in Scripture, or upon life from a scriptural perspective for the purpose of understanding, application, and prayer." So that deep thinking phrase, a big piece there. I mean, meditation is something different than just scriptural study. It's different, I mean, related to prayer, but it's really this deep thinking on a smaller portion of scripture. Two quotes here from different sources that I thought were useful, comparing what meditation is against other things. So sometimes it's helpful to think about what it's not. So from a Desiring God article by David Mathis, it says, "For the Christian, meditation means having the word of Christ dwell in you richly. It is not like secular meditation, doing nothing and being tuned into your own mind at the same time, but it's feeding our minds on the words of God and digesting them slowly, savoring the texture, enjoying the juices, cherishing the flavor of such rich fare. Meditation that is truly Christian is guided by the gospel, shaped by the scriptures, reliant upon the Holy Spirit, and exercised in faith." So I mean, we hear this word meditation, it sort of feels like a new agey word a little bit, which I generally associate with like blank mind, you know, going somewhere else, and I think that's not at all what we have in mind when we talk about scripture meditation. And then another quick quote from Foster, which is really distinguishing meditation from study of scripture. So those are two, you know, they're linked, but separate. So he says, "Whereas the study of scripture centers on exegesis, or really digging into the text, pulling the meaning of the text apart, the meditation of scripture centers on internalizing and personalizing the passage. The written word becomes a living word addressed to you." Quick in terms of expressing and working out scripture meditation. This read big, meditate small, I thought was a great, really short, pithy phrase to think about scripture meditation. It's a useful thing, you know, in your Bible reading. Maybe you're reading a chapter, and then circle back. What, you know, what one verse or two verses really was impactful or said something that affects your personal life or you think is beautiful, whatever. So read big, meditate small. And then this tea bag analogy was used, and I think that's useful. It's this analogy of, like, you know, dunking the tea bag over and over and over again and letting it sort of permeate the cup is sort of this idea of what scripture meditation is. So it's really just sort of dwelling, savoring small bits of scripture. There are 17 different methods in the book. I first saw the list and was like, 17, this seems ridiculous to me. Like, really, 17 methods? They're super helpful. They're like a paragraph or two on each one. If you're looking for a way to maybe like jazz up your scripture meditation, I seriously recommend punching through them. Maybe only two or three of them land, but I really think you might find things that are different that you're like, oh yeah, if I just started asking that consistent question each time, maybe I'd get someplace different than just the way I usually read scripture. So I really, it's at pages 56 to 68. They're all listed out one by one. I think that might be helpful to you. How long am I?
4 minutes.
Oh my gosh. So I'm gonna let Jace, maybe you wanna start telling about your experience.
talked, we each kind of picked a couple we're gonna try. And I was gonna try like illustrating Googling the gospel, which is what I usually do at church if I'm not knitting, but I have my knitting. And then I've been reading Jeremiah in my own personal time, and so the two that I wanted to do, which is see how it points to Jesus, I was like, I can't find it. And then how does it point to a question or a certain circumstance in your own life? Again, reading Jeremiah, I was like, this is not happening. I found what works for me is like if I'm doing something busy with my hands, then I can meditate. So I was like, really leads in is like kind of the center of all other disciplines, in my opinion, like prayer, you know, fasting, solitude, all those things like kind of are, you know, if you're allowing scripture to permeate your life, then they naturally flow out of that. You like, I think scripture meditation actually requires a response of worship or prayer or God doing something.
My wife and I chose to sit down and read together at night, which is not the best suggestion. Don't do it because you can't really focus on it as easily. So, that said, we did it at night. Small child makes for that. We would sit down, we'd read through a chapter and or a section, depending on the meat of the chapter, and then we'd discuss it for about 10, 15 minutes and then pray about it after we were done discussing.
My one practical suggestion is tangible can help. Like, I would read and then write just a verse or two on a note card, and then I carry it around in my pocket all day, and walking through the skyway or whatever. It can really help to have tangible, because being stuck up here sometimes just feels like really abstract. It's like, no, this is, I can grab onto this and see it. So, anyway, I think we're out of time.
You are.
And so we want to share it with you millennials. So it has been done. You know, many godly people have done it, but at the same time, many godly people have also not done it as well. And the closest thing that all the authors would talk about is possibly the Psalms in the Bible is the closest thing to someone actually going out there and journaling. Christians have utilized journaling as a means to preserve reflections. We've heard that multiple times tonight. Also to help solidify how we can apply what we're learning to life, you know, what we do each day. And then, as well, it helps foster and articulate our relationship with God.
So, one of the things that I tend to struggle with, and I look at a lot of spiritual giants kind of and see that they have this very deep love for God that they can express really well. And
one of the things that Whitney said in the book was that we tend to feel most deeply about what we think most deeply about. By slowing us down and prompting us to think more deeply about the things of God, journaling helps us feel more deeply about them. And also that writing in a journal provides an opportunity for the intangible grays of mind work and heart work to distill clearly into black and white. So I'm sure that in many ways you guys have noticed taking notes, making a list, things like that. Just the act of writing things down really helps you remember them. Even if you get your list when you go to the store or you don't open your notes again, just writing them down helps you.
So I'm gonna interrupt. We're gonna have you guys do an experiment for the remainder of our presentation. We're gonna have this side of the room take notes. You guys are not allowed to take notes. Okay.
Over there.
And then Julian, of course, can provide the opportunity for us to express our thoughts and feelings to God.
So these are two studies. The top one was done just to share with you guys. I always think it's cool. As we're learning the different ways that science is backing up and explaining how God designed us, which is amazing. So in this first study, Lieberman had individuals, participants, shown a distressing image, and then half of the group was allowed to write about it afterwards, and the other half was not. And what he found was with the group that was able to write about the image, they found decreased activity in the area of your brain, like the amygdala, which is like the freak out, like center of your brain.
Hmm.
You get emotionally worked up. That's kind of like the guard that tells you it kicks us into fight or flight. And then what happened is, in addition to that, decreased activity or increased activity in our brain's ability, a part of our brain that can regulate emotion and keep us calm, make sense of things and reason. Kind of cool. The second one was a study done where he had people journaling three consecutive days for 20 minutes, and depression symptoms decreased, mood lifted, all these mental health benefits. The big thing here is that journaling is effective therapeutically, psychologically, when we can make sense out of things. So if I'm just like beating myself up through journaling, I'm not going to be helpful. But it helps us because it helps us to reason through our difficulties, which makes sense is how it fits to a spiritual discipline. When we're organizing our thoughts, our feelings, and processing what we're learning through our time with God, through scripture, making sense of things rather than just moving forward.
So, next we're going to talk about ways to journal and things to journal about. I'm sure many of you guys have practiced journaling, there's a variety of different ways. Some of you guys might type it out. Personally, I remember things better when I write things down just on pen and paper. Otherwise, there's blogging. Somebody brought up a prayer journal or a gratitude journal, just giving thanks through your journal and having that be the only purpose of it, or a line a day journal, which can be a great way to get started out. If you are very bad with time management, then it might be helpful to just start out small, take a line and just write it out, and then often from there it will flow into something a lot bigger than that. And you can talk about a lot of different things. So like I said earlier, just prayer requests. You can record daily events, capture interactions with others that you found meaningful, and insights into the scripture, and just meditating on that. Struggles with sin, theological musings, or other random thoughts that you might have during the day.
I can share a little bit about some things that made it easier or helpful for me. So these are some ideas that I did use when I was doing it, and ideas that I want to incorporate moving forward. But I think making things as easy as possible is helpful. I think we can all agree that we can all think of all the reasons why we can't do something. But sometimes it's easier to say, okay, well, how can I do this? So breaking it down into smaller steps. So maybe not expecting myself to journal every day, but maybe starting 3 days a week. Or maybe not committing to writing a whole page, but just writing one sentence. And that often can turn into more really
So for me, that's one thing that was well good for me is having a plan. And in the morning, I usually have my quiet time, and I didn't journal before the assignment, and I started doing it. And like she said, that basically I start out with one sentence, but I was amazed at how soon. I mean, in one sentence, I had two or three pages of journaling, and that really surprised me. I really have enjoyed it.
I carry my journal with me in my purse, which is helpful. I try to not set rules with my journaling, so just I was journaling random thoughts. I found it really helpful in relating with others and solidifying what I'm learning, rather than having this insight or meaning come in quiet time and then it's gone. And then I'll highlight little bits too, like one word, so that if I'm looking for it later on.
7.5 minutes. Sorry,
oh,
guys. Yeah. There's a lot of this for me. Sorry.
Didn't
what
see you.
What was tricky was you told me to take notes, so I was typing on my phone and I didn't do it down over time.
Oh,
so.
Could you repeat that? Could you redo it?
Like
that is proof that journaling.
We were going to ask you guys how well you thought you could retain or reteach the message. So I'm sure it would have proven our point.
Well, if nothing else, I have in my phone.
I've gone through periods, but I've done more. Oh, this one. I think I got a little stain from me.
Ready to go?
Are you ready?
Ready, ready.
Here
we
go.
Okay, so we did fasting, and I felt that John Piper kind of gave a good overview of what fasting is, and he kind of explained fasting as this exclamation point on our longing for Christ. And so it's this idea that once Jesus died on the cross, now we're longing for him, and we can show that emphasis on it by fasting. Whitney also defines fasting as this voluntary abstinence from food for spiritual purposes. So that's kind of what we took on it. We decided to just fast from food, although kind of like what Mandy was talking about, there's a lot of people that fast from social media or from Instagram or other things like that. So we just chose to do food. The type of fasts that we talked about were absolute fasts. So that's going from no food or water. The normal fast is from fasting just from food, and so that's what we did. We drank water and other things as well. But then there's also this idea of this private fast, and so he was talking about this importance of it making sure that we, when we fast, that we just don't go flaunted, that it's really for our own personal reflection of Christ. And also a partial fast, which is also known as a Daniel fast.
Things we did. We all chose to do 24-hour fast and then do water as well, like I said. So some people chose to drink other things as well, but didn't eat any food. And then what we did in place of the meal times, we would do some of the devotionals, some of that extra time, or we would use that time to pray. So when we feel that hunger, we would go to what was our purpose for doing this fast, and we pray for a person, a thing, a circumstance, or kind of meditate on what our focus was. Or think about people around the world who might deal with this often as kind of remembrance of maybe what their experience is like.
So one of the things that we looked at was, were we actually successful? And of course, the key to the success or the ultimate objective was not eating. So we were successful in not eating. Actually, those other things up there, mindfulness, the indwelling of the Holy Spirit, and getting closer to God or feeling closer to God, and the notion of godliness as is illustrated in the book, were really the things that we were looking for. And so those became the primary things. The fasting was just a means to an end. Now, how did we actually do? You can see our kind of our little report card down on the bottom there. So two people did especially well. They came away feeling closer to God. They felt an indwelling of the Holy Spirit, and they were mindful during their entire fasting period. One of us tried to sleep 14 hours out of the 24. So had some success, was pretty mindful in the period of wakefulness. But sleeping 14 hours helped quite a bit. There were two of us, and Mike, we won't name names, you or I, but we were completely distracted during the day, so literally my day went something like, oh, I didn't eat. Honey, do you want to go out to dinner now? So I didn't think about a lot of the things during the day in terms of fasting. I was distracted with work and other stuff.
Thank you, sir. So we had some challenges during the process. Some of it was socially oriented, so the first two kind of go hand in hand. It's like picking a day, like you have a busy schedule, or you're going out for drinks or happy hour with people, and just have busy lives. And you know, telling somebody, hey, I can go out for food, but I can't eat anything. I'll have a water with you. It's kind of awkward. So there are plenty of distractions, as Peter mentioned. I had a busy day at work, and so I had a couple points at which I was like, ooh, I'm hungry, reach for the desk drawer where there's snacks, but it was like, oh, I'm fasting today. But, you know, it's tough when you're just completely swamped and your brain is totally involved in what you're doing to be mindful and actually take time to be present during the process that you're trying to go through and actually get something out of it. So, which is just having enough time to get the full weight out of the exercise that you're going through. And not being able to sleep for a full 24-hour period was terribly challenging for us. So things that were having a purpose, so it would have been helpful to be a little bit more mindful about why we are fasting. I mean, I kind of, this snuck up on me a little bit. I was just like, boom, I'm going to do this fast for this day. And I just did it. Got to the end of the day or the next morning, and it was like, okay, a couple times during the day I was like, hey, there are people who feel like this all the time around the world, and so it's good for me to think that for a moment, but I was not in thoughtful prayer or meditation or otherwise that I could have otherwise been, which would have allowed me to get more out of it. Having a plan, a little bit tied in with what I just mentioned. Some of the gals here had an awesome plan tied to that, being mindful. A couple people thought music was helpful, and just having that on in the background and keeping them all tied together. And, of course, sleep when allowed.
I recommend sleep. Recapping some of the things that we've learned, true fasting requires true suffering, not that it's ripping of skin or just, you know, pain, but to actually feel the hunger and do something different than what you feel like doing, focusing on God versus your bodily needs. If you're not mindful, you're not actually doing anything, meaning that if you're focusing on not eating and you were successful in not eating, well, that really doesn't do any good. You're supposed to be, the whole purpose is to focus on God. And it's the expectation of God. There's a lot of biblical references we should focus on there for fasting, not exactly how to do it, but there's many examples in the Bible about various ways of approaching fasting, a day, an hour, you know, 40 days. I'm going to try it for 40 day one soon. But it was a good lesson. How we do?
With the Lord that looks like with prayer and scripture meditation or memorization. And so Webster Dictionary defined it as a contribution to the welfare of others, which I think is just true, and that is like a tangible way of loving others, responding to the call that God has given us. And I think it was an important distinction to make right away, that when we kind of distinguified the difference between the spiritual discipline of serving and just like the service that is a result of the life transforming presence and work of the Holy Spirit that we like naturally have, and that we are like living our lives hopefully every day looking for ways to serve others, but just kind of how what it looks like to be in that spiritual discipline.
And so there are there's a variety of different ways to serve, groups into two specific categories, being institutional and personal serving. So serving in the church in any role that you can, or serving in a structured environment, going somewhere to with a specific purpose to serve and to do something for a group of people, as well as personal, so just serving people in your everyday life, your roommates, your family, your coworkers, just being able to do things one-on-one that you naturally do with the mindset of serving them for God.
So my wife has been working some late nights, and so when she would come home, my goal was to serve her by having a clean apartment and by providing dinner for her when she'd get home, to provide a relaxing, hopefully stressless environment for her. Some challenges I saw in it was just a physical laziness when I would get home from work. I wanted to rest. And also a temptation to, it was actually after, it was a temptation to take that experience and make it as an excuse to not do something or for something later. Some things that helped was just a kind of a mind reset, just like when I was coming home, just resetting my mind of this is the purpose why I'm doing this, to serve her so that she can be relaxing.
I serve on the Hope AV team and have for the past year, but I joined because it's something I'm good at and something that I enjoy. And last week I was doing the slide switching and realized like, oh, this is service. I've been reading Whitney and it finally clicked for me that I knew that I was doing something that helped Hope and something that needed to be done, filling a position, but this was institutionally versus personally how I was serving the church. And so there is a distinction in acknowledging that service as for the Lord and not just because you like it, not just you're good at it, or it's nothing that just happens to help other people, but you prayerfully devote that time to serving God. We serve at the pleasure of our Lord.
Hey, we're just going to run through some things that we all came across or learned throughout our time. The first one, serving doesn't have to be something new, institutionalized, or unnatural. We often all have opportunities to serve just in our daily life that we just have to make ourselves aware of. And so being able to see those opportunities and really focus on them and see them as an opportunity to serve and not just, as she mentioned, just something we're good at or we want to do. We can use the natural giftings that God has given us. And then this next one is out of the book. These are some of the things that he talked about on how we're called to serve. And it's to be done in obedience to what we're called to do with gratitude and gladness, through forgiveness, with humility and love. And the big one I pulled out of that is it's not you're not serving out of guilt, you're not serving out of requirement, you're not doing it because you feel bad or you need to do it, or maybe somebody told you to do it, but you're doing it because you want to grow in godliness, you want to serve those around you. So those are out of the book.
And then the last few things that God calls us to serve, not to for ourselves, it's as a response, and it's for the purpose of godliness. Sometimes we serve to feel better about ourselves, or oh, I'm so involved in church and I have this many roles. How many do you have? And it's not that purpose, but it's for the purpose of godliness and as a response to Him. And then something that it was a little bit of an offshoot, but we talked about when we met as a group, is that receiving service from others must also be done with humility. I think we're in a culture, and maybe especially in the Midwest, where you want to be able to do everything, and like hospitality has need. Oh, I can do that. But if you have a need, we're all very hesitant to ask for help or ask for service from someone else because we feel vulnerable. Like we can't. Like we want to be able to do it all ourselves. And so, just being open to receiving that within community too is really important. So, yeah.
Wow.
More time.
Yeah, okay. Q&A with Ryan.
We got another 5 minutes.
I thought that was my first instinct. Oh my god, this one was like 6 minute interpretive dance. I totally thought it was you. I thought it was you. I honestly. And then when I learned it was Julie, I was like, oh, that's not as funny. Like, it's funny.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right, here we go. Silence.
Okay, so we are Team Silence. Hi. So for the next 20 seconds, I want you to just look at these pictures in silence and contemplate what the discipline of silence is for, and what is the discipline of silence? All right, hold on to those.
Give you what did Whitney say the definition was, which he said the voluntary and temporary abstention from speaking so that certain spiritual goals might be sought. And one of the main things he highlighted in the book was that it's usually used alongside other disciplines. Most often solitude, like they're in the same chapter in the book, but it's also Bible intake, prayer, learning, or listening to worship music or journaling. And one of the main takeaways we came out of it with was it's more than being just without sound. Actually, it doesn't even have to be without sound. It could be listening to a sermon, it could be listening to worship. But it's about silencing your inner monologue and other human voices, worldly voices, and intentionally seeking God's voice in that time. And I read a really great article by William Ross from the Gospel Coalition, and it talked about why we should practice. And he said it's out of obedience to God, to seek wisdom from God, to assert self-control, to rest, and to just sit in wonder of who the Lord is.
Okay, so this played out kind of in two ways, in the book and then in what we practice. So the first one is taking longer intentional periods of silence, so that's kind of the typical, like, going away from people or just like turning off the radio in the car, or just like setting aside 15 minutes, half hour to kind of silence your thoughts and focus on God. And then the second way is kind of minute retreats. So just throughout our days, taking a moment here, a moment there to kind of stop and be present where you are and kind of consider Christ in those moments.
A lot of what we took away, many of you have already spoken about in about solitude or journaling or other aspects, but a few things to highlight here is we found it can be very difficult not only to silence the input from maybe a radio or something, but your own monologue inside. And in order to do that, we found that what was most effective is not trying to clear your mind and be like them and be a void, but rather choosing a posture and an alignment with the Word of God, which is Christ. And so redirecting yourself and choosing that posture of stillness and rest, and it really was an exercise for us in, one, patience and waiting on God, waiting for His voice, and also obedience, like Mike said, because you, instead of speaking for God and predicting what He might say, legitimately waiting and then being able to say yes to whatever it is that He speaks in that stillness. And then we also were kind of in tune with some biblical examples in different ways. So for me, the musical interludes of silence, those appear in the Psalms with the Selahs. For other people, it was listening to the words of Jesus, like Mary did at the feet of Jesus, as opposed to an action and doing. Other people paired it with solitude, like Jesus retreated up on the mountain
and now because we're on Rob's computer, so we need to work with it.
Oh.
But she actually had a really cool story to tell when she used silence, and she sat in wonder of God, and she had some of answers given to her
mm-hmm.
in those moments of silence about relationships in her life, and it was just really cool, tangible benefit that we got to see.
So yeah, like Maddie experienced and Ruth said as well, some of the ways we experienced the silence was really just aligning with God and stilling our own thoughts and our own voices so that we could hear him better. And so we thought that this verse reflected really well, and we want to take about 30 seconds now to just be still and know that he is God.
By this professional photographer who did kind of a montage of what silence and solitude is to him through his art. So if you guys want to check it out, I don't know if our slides are going to be posted to the city, but if they are, the link to that is on the last slide.
Cool.
Cool.
All right. So well done. You guys look great. Thank you so much for trying these things. And I know a lot of it was probably because I poked at it and I made it homework. But I'm hoping that some of the general feelings were it was good to try something you might try. How many of you was this a stretch in your like daily faith experience? How many of you thought, oh, this is something different? That's it? No one else? Can we get the hands? Can we get real hands? Who thought this was a stretch for them in their daily kind of, I don't normally do this? Okay. Yeah. You don't normally fast? Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. All right. And so just seeing that you're getting to try something new is a good thing. So what were some of the common themes that people saw kind of arc through these things about, let's say, about the benefits? What were the general overarching benefits of practicing these spiritual disciplines?
More of a focus on God and less on me.
Mm-hmm. And done in a variety of ways, right?
Mm-hmm.
Some of them were very active, and some of them were very still and silent. Yeah, other things, other overarching. Yeah.
They really were interdependent. She talked about her. Okay.
You're first. No, no, you're
okay. I felt like they were interdependent. A lot of them overlapped with each other. People commented on other disciplines that were being spoken about throughout the evening as well.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Yeah, I was just going to say it brought a lot of dependence on like reminding me that God's there. I feel like it was easy. It's easy to just go through my day and do my own thing and kind of put him like in boxes where I can fit God time. And so even like at work being like, oh, that's right, like I'm depending on God at this moment.
Yeah. Yep. Emily, then you're up.
To help me reshape how I view my time and to be intentional about looking for the margin or repurposing time and making good use of it for, and that could be said for any discipline, but that's what I thought.
Yeah, recapturing that time. Jeff, over here.
I thought it was sort of cool how all of them, there was sort of like a worldly counterpart, you know, hey, we do this, we clear our minds versus our focus is on God, or I do a journal, you know, it's about me and, you know, how I feel versus, hey, what is my relationship into who God is? So there's there's a, I'll call it a counter that I don't, you know, even like being in a person, versus how we do it in the world.
It's almost like God wired us to react to certain things, huh? Like that, Mike.
I guess maybe not so much a pain, but just a takeaway was just I have more dimensions which I can interact with God through, I guess. Put them in a little different dimensions of pray, I can read, maybe have some, you know, study time with some people, but there's meditation, there's fasting, there's some of the other ways of interacting with God.
Yeah.
I think the power of scripture and all of it, even in things like prayer or worship or being silent, that I just how powerful it is to constantly be putting God's word inside of our minds and hearts.
Yeah, knowing God, right? Through his word, understanding who he is, his character, his heart for us, his heart for the world, the ways in which he would have us behave. Those are huge things. And we saw all of these disciplines circle back to that, right? Circle back to that internal motivation. Yeah.
Except for perhaps solitude, I also was struck by how all of these can work in tandem with like large group settings, for example, like corporate worship, and also smaller pairs or trios and personal things as well, just like doing that.
Yeah, and it is funny how in some ways solitude though is linked to the corporate thing, because I think personally as an extrovert, unless I felt external, like, I don't know, pressures are terrible. Unless I had peer pressure or at least moral support, I wouldn't choose solitude. Like, that wouldn't be my natural go-to. Yeah, my husband would be that cat, though he doesn't love cats. Yeah, Prophet.
In reading in our chapter, one thing that we talked in our like small group gathering before here was about the story of the man. I think he had like a bad car accident or something, like he lost his hands and his like face. And like he longed for God's word so much that like he was reading Braille from his tongue.
Oh.
And I was like, that was super weighty for me, because I was like, I am fully able. Has to read it that way, and I'm like, wow, like, you know, I could not be lazy.
Yeah.
Pick that up.
Yep.
So.
Yep. I can read. And just even being educated will have to read on our own, right? You think about why was journaling probably not written about in the Bible? Most people weren't literate, right? It was oral tradition and read through them, right? We
take
can
a lot
read,
of time
right.
to chip on the tablet.
It did. I bet parchment wasn't cheap, right? Yeah.
In the very first part of the book, when the spiritual disciplines were being introduced, Whitney introduced this notion of the whole purpose here is godliness.
Mm-hmm.
And I actually took some offense to that, because it's like, it seems selfish. So, unless you really define godliness.
Okay.
As being God-focused and relationship-focused.
We would say gospel-centered here at Hope, right?
Sure.
We would say gospel-centered, right? Because godliness is can be confusing. Like, you could think of it as right behavior,
yeah,
right?
Exactly.
If
and
you
that,
grew up in that tradition.
And that's, you talked a lot about the elect and with our focus on the Reformation and
right.
Calvin right now especially. It came off that way at the beginning of the book.
Did anyone read the Packer forward and go, what, about reading it 3 times in 3 months and think, wow, that's legalism. I mean, it's not a bad idea. He said, unless you do it, you can't grow in God. And I thought that's a funny way to start a book on spiritualism. Go back and read it if you didn't have a chance. I was immediately thrown by it and walked right back into Robert Julie's office and like, what did you give me? Was that you, Julie?
Yeah.
I love this. Have you made it past the forward? No. Stacy.
Yes. I don't remember which other book it was, but I read one of the other ones, and it explained spiritual disciplines a little bit more, like, make just creating space for the Holy Spirit. Like, the Holy Spirit is going to still do all of the work, but we're basically, like, hoeing the rose so that he can plant and do what he needs and water and all that stuff, but we're making the space. And that, to me, made a lot of sense.
Yeah, and what if we didn't use the word discipline? I think that's a really great
great comment, right? So discipline's a tough word, and it speaks of legalism, especially if you grew up in like a church background that focused a lot of it on the doing and jumping through Christian hoops. But what if we just said like it's like a Christian workout plan? I mean, I'm averse to working out, so that doesn't thrill me. But pick your word, you know, it's essentially our Christian fitness plan. Or something that's more palatable, but the idea that we're doing it in pursuit of God, in pursuit of gospel living, of gospel relationships, of growing in our walk with God. I want to switch gears just a little bit more to talk quickly about the impediments that prevent this. What were the general themes we saw there? And Emily, you touched on it. It's time, a repurposing, gaining back time. I know that whenever I want to practice a new spiritual discipline, if I set down my phone, even 25%, if I laid it down 25% of the time that I'm normally staring at it, I probably gain back enough to do a lot of spiritual disciplines, yeah? Yeah. So what were some of the common impediments besides time?
I think discipline, like we mentioned in the silence, just the discipline of it. Like, I turned off my podcast on my way to work, but then my thoughts were elsewhere, so then I immediately put the excuse on, well, I'm thinking about something else anyway, so I might as well put my podcast
on. I can't memorize scripture,
yeah,
so I might as well not try.
Yeah. Yeah. If you're not in practice, it's just really hard.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I think there's a few cases where there's like illness or sickness, but the big theme I saw was just a lack of priority.
Mm-hmm.
What Pastor Steve talked about this morning is mankind constantly puts itself in a position that only God deserves.
Yep.
So we put these things in our life, and then we all make excuses that we're busy with things that we put in our life, and we don't have time to put Him where He belongs.
Yeah, we're great with excuses. Yeah,
yeah.
Great. Yeah.
This wasn't an impediment for us because we had accountability and community while doing this, but going forward in the future, a lack of support from community will be an impediment.
Yeah.
So I think keeping it up with your gospel community and gospel friends around you is going to be hugely important.
Mm-hmm. And I think one of the big things that I noticed as an impediment was a lack of like vision for why we're doing this, or that undergirding sense of what we're trying to accomplish with it. So I think people struggle with the fasting. Was it Mike, was it you said I just went through my day and I didn't really think about why? That doesn't really help us gain, right? If we're not understanding why we're just doing, we're going back to more of that box checking, which is I think something we all fall into. So the great thing about the gospel is if we find ourselves practicing spiritual disciplines and we realize they're becoming very legalistic, what we can do is offer ourselves grace and keep trying to do it out of a fullness of heart, out of a response to the gospel. So rather than deeming ourselves a failure for being legalistic about our spiritual disciplines, we just extend ourselves the same grace we would hopefully extend to somebody else, or the grace that we know God extends to us, right? Forgive ourselves and pick it back up and try again, right? I think the temptation is to throw it aside. I'm no good at it. I can't memorize scripture. And I can either say, shame on me, or I'm not smart enough, or whatever, whatever, whatever. Or I can extend myself grace, and tomorrow I can pick up anything but Romans 1 and try to memorize it. Right? Or Romans 2. I'm just going to steer clear of Paul and Jim. All right. Does that make sense? So I could either look back on my failure and call it and have shame, and then, of course, not be able to tell any of you guys about it because I'd be feeling tons of shame about it. Or I can just acknowledge that, well, you know, I can probably do better. And out of that, out of response to being able to read God's word and not have to use my tongue to do so, I can look at it and I can memorize it and I can meditate on it and I can do those things, right? Because I think the temptation, especially as people as motivated as you all here are, that brings you to off-road, is to mark your spiritual attempts as a failure. And I just want to kind of leave you with that note of saying that there's no truth to that. That's a lie. And you need to then find a piece of scripture on God's forgiveness and memorize it, and meditate on it, and learn it, and then apply it in your solitude, right? I had a lot memorized from when I was younger. I've also used the excuse of now that I'm older, it's harder. My brain, like a rot started to happen when I turned 40. I'm not sure if that's real or imagined.
Imagine.
Enough to be your mom, Emily. We have the same last name. funny this morning. I'm not her mother, just so you know. Okay, and then the last thing that I wanted to talk about was there's likely one of these disciplines that God kind of poked at your heart. So just think back, which one jumps out to you? I would recommend you just try that one next, right? And again, just trying these things will expand that repertoire. Maybe share it with your cohort in your time. I think we gave you some like summary questions. Is that what we call them? Reflection questions. And I did put this in there, but that'd be a great thing to like, what can I try next? And not in a way that says I have to do this to win God's favor. I have to do this to prove to you I'm the super Christian who should be an off-road. None of those things. To do it in a way that says I can try this. I can expand my understanding of ways I can learn about God, and I can honor Him, and I can worship Him, and I can serve others. Yeah? So let's just make a corporate attempt in our successes and in our failures to keep moving forward in our pursuit of God through His Holy Spirit. Yeah? All right, that's it. That's all I got. Is that all I need?